Iris worldwide. We're an innovative marketing agency. I also have a couple other companies that focus on enterprise sort of applications, education, things with VR, and data visualization, analytics, tracking, and also advice to a VC fund that is specializing in IoT, VR, and AR projects. So I get across a lot of the different areas of VR and AR. At Iris, we're a marketing sort of company, so most of the things we're doing are for brands, whether it's events, activations, or mobile sort of applications. But we also do a lot of things ranging from EDMs to high-budget TV ads, a bit of everything in between. From our side of things, I started playing around with VR about 5 years ago or so, and with working with advertising, I realized that most people just don't pay attention to any of it anymore because it's everywhere, so you just kind of drain it out. Like pretty much, when was the last time you actually clicked on a flash banner or even noticed what was on the content without just skipping straight past it? So at Iris we focus on participation. And one of the big things that we do is we always try and build participation into all of our brands. So it's not just be a passive consumer of it, it's become involved, get to enjoy the brand, like them, see what they stand for, and participate in the different things they're doing. So for the last 10 years or so, pretty much everyone thought that was social media. If someone goes and likes your brand on Facebook, then they think that's participation, which it's not really, because people don't really pay attention to a lot of stuff they like or share anymore. It's just click it for the hell of it. So with VR, we can actually push people much further to participate, get involved with it, and play around with the brand, get to enjoy them, and really get into what the brand's trying to achieve. So we've been working with VR and Iris for a number of years now, and we've worked across a pretty big range of brands, all in different sort of areas, trying to achieve different goals, but all the VR stuff so far has worked really well. We've got people really engaged, and brands are starting to actually recognize ROI from their investment in these kind of things, which is always pretty tricky, especially in Asia, when you're trying to do untested sort of things to get it out in front of people and get a decent bit of money and put something together. So a lot of people working with games for VR, if you run into different kind of challenges where you have to spend a lot of time optimizing your technology and things, and we're doing things for brands like this, it's normally around events and activations, where pretty much we can just throw a couple of the most expensive high-end technology into a machine that we can custom build and water cool, and we can focus purely on the content. So we might get to build in 40 elements, we've done things with fans and displays and moving platforms. The one we've got on the back there, we've actually got one of the 5 trackers and it's on a rugby ball, and you physically have to throw it. It's not something anybody's ever going to be able to do at home, really, but because we're only trying to do it for a one-off type thing, we can really mess around and have a lot of fun. So we're actually partners with a lot of technology providers, so we've been working closely with Google, HTC, Samsung, one of our clients, Microsoft as well. So we were in the first wave of developers for the HoloLens. We've had a bit over a year now, we've been playing around with that, but a lot of fun. Still a lot of problems, but it's still a lot of fun to play around with. So we're enterprise partners with APAC, the guys that make the Unreal Engine. I was just in Shanghai last week, where they had a big presentation there, and 1,300 people from Shanghai were at a conference there. And every single setup, apart from the ones that they had at this conference, was all VR. So all the game developers in China are heavily getting on VR. So a lot of people over here, everyone always asks us why we work with Unreal instead of Unity. And it's because we get really good support out of Unreal. And we're enterprise partners with them, so we get extra kind of support with them. Especially if you're general kind of one, you get community support. If you go on and say, hey, we're trying to put 5 trackers on a drone and fly around a room attached to a robotic arm, no one can really help you with that. But at least when we get direct access into Tim Sweeney, the CEO, or any of the CTOs, whoever that's actually going to be able to help with the problem, helps us get things out pretty quickly. So we were able to create some pretty decent kind of projects, but all of this, especially in marketing, you get low budgets, tight time frames, and things are pretty tough to pull off. So from those ones that you saw, the longest time frame that we had to do a project was 3 months. That included a couple of us flying over to Fiji and filming footage, editing it, bringing it back, mixing in VR, building the actual physical structures and things. And that's our longest sort of project. The shortest one we had was 4 weeks. So the skiing game that you saw up there, that from start to finish, setting up an event over in Chicago and again in Barcelona, development time on that was 4 weeks in total. And we're actually a pretty small team, there's only 5 of us. So we've got a developer, a 3D modeler, a video editor, a generalist, all rounder sort of one, and one business guy. So all of that is a pretty small sort of team. And as I mentioned, convincing people to throw money at untested, unknown sort of mediums is tricky enough as it is. Once you move into VR, it's something that you can't understand until you actually try it out. So normally when we try and pitch VR to someone, that just gives a look like that. And especially when we want decent kind of budgets to do decent kind of projects, people are pretty wary about it. And especially over here, where everyone kind of works on their 6 monthly sort of KPIs to get their bonuses, they're not keen to take a risk on something and potentially mess out. But we found that it's been a bit of a tougher sort of sales pitch over here, but I've been working with one since the Oculus VK1, pitching clients, trying to get things. And it took me about 3 years to get one across the line before a client finally kind of said, okay, yeah, we'll take a chance and give a little bit of money to do something with it. And that's kind of paid off quite well for us so far. But it took a lot of rejection before finally someone actually said yes. And how that actually happened. So when we're trying to get things out there and talk to people about VR, as I mentioned, you can't comprehend it until you try stuff out. Especially if you're familiar with the technology, it's easy, you understand it, you know how things work. But trying to get somebody who's never tried it out, especially someone that might have tried out 360-degree video before, that's never actually tried out interactive proper virtual reality, it's really tough to convince them what the difference is there. And when you want to try and come along and add an extra 0 or 2 to the cost, you've got to have a way of justifying that. Now, so the way we do that is we prototype. Everything. The Fiji project that you saw, where we had the hut and everything in there, put together a prototype in 1 day with that, did a 10-hour flight to Fiji, did a 1-hour meeting, and had the CEO and managing director of Fiji Airways crawling around on the floor on their hands and knees looking at virtual fish. But once that's kind of happened, it's pretty easy to sell the rest of it. Whatever engine you're developing with, whether it's Unreal or Unity or any kind of one, there's a lot of assets that are available online for cheap or free. And even if it saves you a couple of hours, it's well worth it for a prototype because you don't want to be wasting time on this. You're investing your own time and money into it. And if you spend a month trying to make something look good before you show it to somebody, it could be too late if you're already done. So use the marketplace assets. You might not actually use them in the final project, but to get an idea across in your prototype, they really come in. We've had ones where we've picked up something for $5, it might save us a day, which is completely worthwhile, even if it's a throwaway for a few dollars, who cares? This one's a Unreal specific kind of one, but there are plugins for Unity, which let you get around from having to do proper coding. So there's a few different ones in Unity, but built straight into Unreal is the blueprinting system, which is essentially a node-based coding kind of one. And it might not be as efficient, or proper programmers might not like it because it's not proper programming, you struggle with unit tests, but to put things together and to be able to get something up and running quickly, the blueprints have been really great for us. Especially when you're doing virtual reality stuff, you want to try and debug some code, something that's gone wrong, you're standing up, you're walking away from your desk, you can't read where your breakpoints are, you can't see what's going on. With the blueprints, you can actually visualize code as it's happening, you've got a bright red dot, moving lines that are showing you exactly what's going on. So it's the same as dozens of hours just being able to quickly pull up the headset and see what's happening with these things. So, make mistakes. When you're doing a prototype and just trying to get something out in front of somebody, don't have to worry about being perfect. No one is actually going to notice any of the things that are wrong with it, because it's likely that you're only putting somebody in for 30 to 60 seconds to try out the prototype. and you just want your content to be good enough to wow them, that they don't care what notice any little bugs we have, anything. We'll often find that we'll spend days or even more than that nitpicking about tiny little details in there, which we notice because we sit within the thing all the time. But if somebody that's never tried it and has no idea what they're actually trying to do with it, they don't notice those things. So just forget about it and move on, get the thing done in front of somebody to get some proper criticism. And the final thing would be always assume that you're wrong. Any assumption you have about how people will use your technology, what they'll do with it, you're going to be wrong 90% of the time. Especially as developers, when you're used to working with technology, you start to know how you should do it, things become natural to you. Someone's never tried it before, it's not. They will have no idea how to use your stuff. So get it out in front of people, test it, find out how they're doing it, record video of it, put in eye tracking, Google Analytics, anything you can to try and test how people are using your technology, and then develop from there. Because you'll find that you'll change 90% of what you actually thought you should do beforehand. So, as I mentioned, the stuff that we do that's the most fun is building these big event-based ones. So for this GE Airways type one, we built the physical hut, and we 3D scanned the chair that's in the middle of it. So everything that you see there was exactly represented in virtual reality, which meant you can walk in, you put on the VR headset, you can feel the chair, and you know exactly where it is. You're comfortable to stand up, walk over to the window, lean out the window, look around, and it just makes everything much more immersive once you add these 4D kind of effects to it. And that's where we get to have a lot of fun. But we actually have 10 of the vibe trackers, so we can do full body motion tracking, put on props, we're doing 3D printing and other electronic stuff to just hook up different kind of elements into it, which is not something you'd expect somebody at home to try and go out and buy $1,500 worth of hardware just so they can have a 3D printed gun or whatever to play around with. But for event stuff, it's great. But events tend to be expensive, and especially if you're doing it at an expo, like a travel expo or entertainment type expo or anything like that, event space is expensive. So unless you're setting up half a dozen of these headsets, you're not actually going to get that many people through it. Even if it's a couple of minute experience, you've got about a minute or so to swap people around between your headsets. So you're only getting through maybe a few hundred people at these events. The most we've done, I think, in 3 days was about 300 to 400 people through an event with a single headset. So if you have a few there, you can get a couple thousand people through, but it tends to get quite expensive depending on what you're doing. So the way we create everything is we also do a couple of ultimate versions. So we have our ultra high-end experience, which is our big 4D event type ones. And then we also create 360 videos or mobile interactive versions of them. So at the event, we also set up for this one 3 VR headsets. And it's not a big investment for us, $1,000 each. We've since upgraded to Daydream because it's much easier to actually develop for, especially when we're putting things out to clients for them to take around. You don't need to get the hardware back each time. But getting a higher end kind of version, you know, 360 video or interactive type mobile versions, depending on the sort of content you're editing, it lets you get a lot more people through the event that might not want to wait in line or might not have time on their lunch break to sit and go through a 2 to 3 minute kind of experience in a big kind of one. And then we also do Google hardware headsets for everything that we do. Because we've created the 360 video, it's easy to put it out there, put it up on YouTube, and then anyone can watch it on YouTube. We've got Facebook 360, Vimeo now supports it. In China, you've got Youku 360. And it's obviously, the quality is not as good as what you can get because YouTube actually compresses the things down a lot. Because we normally have a 2 minute kind of video at 4K resolution, comes out to about 5 gigabytes, which is not something you expect people to stream. So you get compression artifacts and things in there. But there are kind of ways around that. And it's just good enough to get somebody into it. And even if they've done the experience, they remember the event, they remember the feeling that they got from the event when they get home. So especially for one like this, where maybe someone was walking through the event space on their lunch break, they wanted to look at it, but it's unlikely they're going to stop and buy a $2,000 plane ticket on the spot. But you send them the headset, a couple of weeks later, send them a reminder about it, and then they sit at home and share it with their husband, wife, whoever, talk about it, and then maybe they buy a ticket. So you can definitely get a lot more people through your experiences by saturating the market across all different mediums, essentially. So, and outside of the marketing type side of things, we're also doing a lot of work in some other spaces. These are the prime sort of sectors that we've identified for virtual reality work. And the industrial sectors, as we saw in the previous presentation, it's huge for that. Being able to understand the data and everything about it is huge for how people design cities, how they work with them, and everything else with it. Education is another big one that we're focusing on, because you can actually understand information that way. So the great thing about the current state of VR is that we can do things with $2,000-$3,000 worth of hardware that universities have been doing for 20 odd years, but they might spend $100,000-$200,000 setting up a cave installation with trackers that only work for one person at a time. And it's complicated. You build one for one system, it doesn't work on any other system because it's very, very specialized. Anybody now can go out and buy a $2,000 computer and a $1,000 device for Oculus sort of setup and have that, if not better quality than what these guys have been doing for hundreds of thousands. So one of the ones that we've been doing in the education sort of sector, this is a quick little prototype which demonstrates from us how the prototyping kind of one works, because this is maybe combined 20 hours of work. But within this kind of prototype, you have all the elements of the periodic table, you put them in the machine and see the electron ring structure. Similar to this for education is great because it's information that the human mind can't actually process it properly. Trying to think about things that at a smaller scale than we can actually comprehend doesn't work. But the way kids learn about it in school now is from a picture in a textbook or maybe a video that the teacher puts up on screen. By being able to let them drop right into the world, play around, pick things up with their hand, shrink themselves down to tiny scales or go up to huge scales, unless you really understand the information that they're looking at, I think there's huge, huge opportunity to the education for these kind of things. Now, the way this one is set up so quickly is within the Unreal Engine and similar kind of methods within Unity, all this kind of data is already open source. Pretty much grab all the elements of the periodic table from an Excel spreadsheet, put them into the system. We have a hell of a lot of information about these things. You get the boiling points, melting points, atomic weight, everything in there straight from an Excel spreadsheet that we can drop straight into the visualization software and then make it interactive. And it just makes things hugely sped up. And so the other one that we've been working on as well is in the industrial sector. And this is quite similar to the previous kind of mapping project, except this one was done and demoed at a European utility meeting in Barcelona. I've been working with some different kind of people on that side. This was done with an energy consulting sort of company. So they go through and they have dozens of layers of different information about this map. So you have all the heights, you have all the building structures, you have everything else in there. But we also have the underground power grid, we have flood risk areas, high sort of risk areas, high traffic areas, roads, busy junction, everything like that, which you can see some visualization on here. And essentially what they'll do, the energy client will come to them and say, hey, we've got a power plant over here, and we need to get power over here. Tell us the most effective way we can do that. So they'll go through, they run it through the software, which calculates all that, and they say, okay, build it this way, it'll cost you $10 million, build it this way, it'll cost you $30 million. All they get from that is a spreadsheet. The client looks at the spreadsheet and goes, okay, I'll do it this way, without really understanding why. In virtual reality, this was a quick little prototype done within 20 hours, which pretty much just based off Westworld, where they have a holographic map. You can walk around it and spin around, but then you can shrink yourself down, go to a human scale, walk around the environment, see what it looks like. Pretty much, if you come into this environment, shrink yourself down, stand there, you realize it's going to cost so much more to go option B, because there's a mountain in the way. And that's stuff that is immediately obvious in virtual reality, but looking at a spreadsheet, you have absolutely no idea. So they just take people on their word with that. So the next one I'm going to show you is from the Unreal Enterprise area. So we've been working closely with APAC for about 12 months now, when they created the enterprise tech team specifically around people like us, BMW, McLaren. Guys that are going to them, they're like, hey, we don't want to build games with this stuff. We're still building games sometimes, but we're trying to create more high-end, specific kind of software that works with different kind of things. So they created a team which specifically works with people like us. We get dedicated support. Obviously, we pay for it. We have a different kind of licensing structure than the free sort of models that you get for developing games. But just being able to actually chat directly with someone that's developing the engine makes a huge difference to us. We're actually working closely with Google and the developers at the moment on the Tango integration with Unreal, which should hopefully be coming out public soonish. I'm not sure. Someone around here probably knows the better sort of dates than I do, but it lets us get this kind of stuff into the Tango. So I'll jump into the video now. So at the moment we're creating several different VR AR projects for our different clients around the world and our other offices. So Iris is probably a bit of an unknown to most people here. We've got about 1,200 people around the world. My team here focusing on VR is 5. We're expanding and looking to expand a lot more rapidly as well. So anybody that's interested in doing a lot of cool VR stuff, come and have a chat with us. There's a couple other people from my team will be up the back tonight. We've got a demo from a little experience that we did a couple weeks ago. You know, play. We've got a daydream one and a DVR sort of demo as well. So pop by and have a look and say hi.
Thanks, team. Why don't you hang there for a second? I'm going to go to the audience and see if there's any questions. Actually, I'll give you one. Of all the stuff you've seen on VR so far, what have you been most impressed with? Outside of the work that you should produce yourself.
There's a lot of really amazing work, but I think for me, especially from the sort of stuff that I'm working in, some of the enterprise grade type ones are really impressive because it's showing just what the technology is capable of, especially on the medical side of things where people are starting to visualize things which are really, really hard to understand on paper, but you can pick it up in virtual reality and instantly understand how the things work. Some of the stuff we had to do around the GIS visualization sort of things was trying to figure out simple ways to get people to interact with it. And that's one of the hardest things for us to figure out at the moment is letting someone have a highly technical sort of tool but be able to pick it up and understand how to work with it without any instruction. So the guys that are doing that sort of stuff are doing amazing jobs with it. And so no one's an expert and everyone's kind of figuring out how to go.
Any questions? You know, they're hanging around, so you can go up to them afterwards and check out the demos too as well. Thank you again, Dean.